99. Singing? I didn't hear all the voices. So we'll try it again. Number 495. Cheers.
have a few announcements that I want to bring to your attention. You can see them in your bulletin. I'm not going to enunciate on all of them. There is a name I'd like to bring to you, Alina Lopez. If you would be praying for her, she needs a place for her and her two children to live. And so let's be praying that she finds an apartment for her. And also, you'll notice in your bulletin that January 6th through 16th, we have our 10 days of prayer again. And we want to remember that, participate in that. And then also Operation Christmas Child. Last year, we were hoping to do about 25 to 30 shoeboxes. And we were able to do just a little over 100. And so that big, huge box is out in the corridor there. Make sure you fill it next Sabbath with things that for the shoebox so that these kids in other countries that don't have what we have can experience a happy Christmas. And also, there the Thanksgiving food drive. Remember to bring your things in. And then December 5th, there we have the Christmas card that we do for the nursing home. So remember that. Look at it in your bulletin. And then December 19, we have our Burnt Mills Christmas party. Remember that. Put it on your calendars. Thank you.
Number 462, as we continue. 462, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Blessed Assurance. Salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Amen. Amen. 528, Shelter in the Time of Storm.
Mm-hmm.
shade by day, defense by night, a shelter in the time of storm. No fears alarm, no foes affright, a shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade on a burning sand, faithful guide for the pilgrim's band, a shelter in the time of storm. Shelter in the time of storm, we find in God a safe retreat, a shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade on a burning stand, faithful guide for the pilgrim's band, a shelter in the shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade on a burning sand, faithful guide for the pilgrim's band, a shelter in the time of storm. Our next song would be 590, Trust and Obey. 590. We will sing verses 1, 3, and 5. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but a toll he that richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but it's blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey. Verse 5. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey. Congregation, please stand.
Father in heaven, we come here this morning to worship you in songs of praise and in prayer and in the reading of your word. And Father, we ask that you would meet with us, that you would fill us with your spirit, and that you would grant to us your Sabbath blessing. And we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. There, I want to welcome the Heartland Choir this morning. There, every year at this time, the Heartland Choir comes and puts on a program for us, and we look forward to it with anticipation. So thank you so very much for coming and bringing us a special time of music. For those of you who do not know about Heartland, it is a college down in central Virginia. And you know, ancient Israel had, excuse me, the schools of the prophets. And when you read the Old Testament, you discover that Elisha and Elijah, they went and made rounds visiting these schools of the prophets. And in these schools, they studied the Old Testament scriptures that they had, the books of Moses and some of the writings of the earlier prophets that they had. And they also studied music, and they also studied poetry. And, you know, some of the psalms that we have may have come from some of those individuals. And so it was a school that was designed to train the young people to honor God with their lives and to live a life of sharing him with others, because they saw their job, their life job, besides earning a living for themselves and their family. They saw their life job as helping others to grow in a relationship with God in heaven. And so Heartland, that is their goal. They're a part of their general curriculum that they have. And not only that, but, you know, their mission is to train young people to take the gospel to the world. And we need young people. If you look, excuse me, at the pioneers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, they were basically in their 20s. James White in 1844 was 21. Ellen White, Ellen Harmon at the time, was 17. There you look at the other leaders. Some of them were 17, 15, 12 in 1844. But the Lord used that generation of young people to take this message that we have to the world. And you people now that are sitting in this congregation are a part of that. God has given to us a task to take the gospel to the world. And that's what these young people are taught. That while they have, a learning to support themselves and their future families, they have a greater mission. That's to take the gospel to the world. So I'm thankful for the goal that Heartland has. And, if any of you are interested in Heartland, you know, sending your child there, contact, you know, speak with one of these young people or, the leaders that they have here today and the representatives, and they would be more than happy to sit down with you and explain it to you. I know if I had a child, I would look at Heartland to send my child to. And so the theme of their concert this morning is Nations Will Praise You, and it's drawn from Psalm 67, and so I want to read Psalm 67 to you. Turn with me there in your Bibles, and while you're turning there, let me just say something. You know, it's a joy to raise our voices with our amens in praise to God. You know, when we clap our hands, we're praising the performer. But when we raise our voices in amen, we are affirming the individuals praising God with their voices or their instruments. And so let us this morning give our praise to God, who deserves it all, with our fervent amens. Psalm 67. And the psalmist says, God be merciful unto us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, that thy way may be known upon the earth, thy serving health among all nations. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. O let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For thou shalt judge the people righteously and govern the nations upon the earth. Let all the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. Then shall the earth yield her increase, and God, even our own God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, and all the ends of the earth shall fear him.
You are all going to help us begin our choir concert this morning. We're going to have an opening hymn together, and it's 229, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. And you're going to sing along with us, but I'm going to give you a little warning. You're going to hear things that the choir is going to do. Keep singing. After the third stanza, there'll be a little interlude that we'll all listen to the piano play. And then on the fourth stanza, we come in together. And then when the fourth stanza finishes, you can just listen to a very special ending that the choir will give. So let's stand together.
Thank you.
Before we have the call for the offering, I'd just like to mention that, as you know, Adrian and Sigri, well, Sigri anyway, is in the hospital. Her water has broke and labor pains have started. So quietly pray for her. In fact, let's have a word of prayer right now for her. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for this young couple and this new life that will come into their family. And so I pray that you'd be with Sigri and the little one that she is delivering. May everything go perfectly, and may mother and child be healthy in every way. I ask in Jesus' name, amen. Now, I need to call three people down to the front. Ruth, would you come down, please? And Elisa, I know you're here because I talked with you. Here comes Elisa, here's Ruth. And Collins, you're here someplace. If you would come down, please. There, as you know, we had a gift of the Conflict of the Ages series to everybody that came to the meetings that we had and didn't miss a meeting. And come over here. And then we also give a Conflict of the Ages series to every individual that we baptize. And unfortunately, when we went to the ABC, they were out of them, and they ordered them for us, and we have them here. So we want to present them to these candidates. Collins, since you're a male, we'll give you the brown one.
The song that I will be playing for offertory.
Good morning, church. Today's offering is for Global Mission, which is the frontline mission arm of the church. These pioneers work within their own culture where they understand the community and speak the local language, along with helping people with their basic needs, such as food, water, shelter, healthcare, and education. If you would like to contribute to this mission, please mark it so in your tithe envelopes. Will the deacons please come forward?
If you'd like to follow along, the hymn that I'll be playing is found in 559.
Thank you.
Can the congregation please rise for the offertory?
Bow your heads with me. Father in heaven, we have brought your tithe into the storehouse, Lord. I pray that you take it, multiply it, and use it to further your work. Please, Lord, also take this children's offering, do with it the same. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Now it is time for the children's offering, and when the children come down, I ask that you don't forget to go down the side aisles. And also, there will be no children's story. Can the children please come forward?
To come before the throne of grace and to clear our hearts and souls and gather strength for this coming day and the coming week. So as far as possible, before we do that, I'm sorry, in the bulletin, there's names of those who are seeking special prayer. We ask that you remember them this week in your prayers. And now if we could bow to our knees as far as possible and we'll pray. Precious Holy Father, glory and honor and praise be to your holy name. As thou hast called us out of darkness into your marvelous light, praise be to your name. As thou hast given unto us your holy word and your holy spirit, praise be unto your name. As you have given unto us from the Garden of Eden the privilege of marriage, praise be to your name. As you've let us take from that wonderful world, a sinless world, this holy Sabbath, praise be to your name. As you've set up your house in this world, O Lord, to abide among us, that we may be and live in your presence, praise be to your name. O Holy Father, have mercy on us when we've fallen short of your glory. Have mercy on us, O Lord, when we're satisfied with a name or profession but deny the power of God. Have mercy on us when we know your ways and your wills, but we don't live it. Have mercy on us, O Lord, when we don't come into the full relationship, the at-one-ment, the atonement that you offer each one of us. Precious Father in heaven, keep us by your grace, Lord. Help us to study your word and not only to know it, but to live it. Father in heaven, we pray for each one in this congregation. We pray your blessing upon them. May we have a rich supply of your Holy Spirit. As your Holy Spirit is here, may you find free access to each heart and each mind. Father, there's many, many here that are struggling this past week. There are many that had difficulties and hardships. May they know, as with Joseph, you are with them, Lord. There are many that had precious victories this week, Lord. May they know that it has come from you, and there's many more, and that we can move from victory unto victory. And there's many, Father, suffering with illness, Lord, that don't have even the energy to pray, the energy to read your Bible, but may they hold on to thee, O Lord, the eternal. And may you bring them healing, Father. Bless and be with this church, Father. Bring revival and reformation. And let it be to thy name's honor and glory and praise. And we think now of those who are in the bulletin asking for special prayer, Lord. Send them healing. Send them help. You know their needs. You know their desires, Lord. May you redefine them, elevate them, convict them through thy Holy Spirit. And Father, thank you now for hearing and answering our prayer. Thank you now for the college that has come to share their faith with us. We've already had a hint of the angels' voices. May our hearts be open and our minds be open to receive of what you have to give us through them. Bless us now, we pray, in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. That's better. Good to see you this morning. My name is David Simons, and I have the privilege of narrating our Thanksgiving concert this morning. So as you've already been told, this choir, and there's actually more than one, it comes from Heartland College. And there are also a number of musicians from many parts of the world who today will be sharing with you their gratitude for God's gifts and for his goodness. There are many reasons to praise God, but the most important one is God's personal intervention in each of our lives. This begins with the death of his Son on the cross, his resurrection and intercession for us in the heavenly sanctuary, and his promises to come again. Our program this morning is entitled The Nations Will Praise You. The students of Houghton College represent many nations. As I call out those nations, choir members from those countries will raise their hands. So firstly, we have American Samoa, Argentina, Brazil, Colombia, India. It's quite a few of them. Indonesia, Japan, Korea, Kenya, Mexico, New Zealand, Nigeria, Romania or Moldova, Russia, South Africa, South Korea, St. Martin, Suriname, Sweden, of course, the United States of America. We have some of them with us today. And the United Kingdom. Okay, also just to let you know, when you go downstairs for lunchtime, you will see that there will be many different flags representing the nations here on the wall. And right now, at this moment in time, we invite you to enter into our praise this morning and let the words and music of these songs soak into your soul. May you be blessed.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath. I have been asked to share my testimony, but before I do, I would like to offer a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for how you have worked in each and every one of our lives. And as I prepare to share, I just ask, Father, that you may be heard and seen at all times. And this is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I feel like because of my background, I was an Adventist from the beginning. I was raised in a very God-fearing home. I was adopted by a very lovely woman. She took in my younger brother, my younger sister, and I, and my older brother at one time. We didn't miss, I can probably count to you on a number of fingers how many times we missed church. It was very rare, even when we were sick. She got me involved very early, and I am thankful and grateful for the mother that I had. Now, my life after that did not always seem like I was grateful. In 2007, the Lord intervened and decided that he wanted to move our family from Florida to Indiana to give us a better life because I had been getting involved with the wrong crowd and my mother wanted something better for me. So we moved to Indiana and I started going to school, but the same behavior kept recurring. Until one day, me and my mother got into an argument in the car and she went inside and I thought that, you know, the school was done dealing with me, basically, and so I went to the door hoping to, you know, be able to get in, but they would not let me in. And the next thing I know, a police car comes up and they end up taking me to a juvenile, like you could call it, troubled boys home, but I was there for a night. Went home and me and my mother still weren't getting along. And eventually it just ended up that I went back there and I ended up staying there from the age of about 16 till I was 19. And when I turned of age to be able to, I guess you age out of the system, they gave me two options. You can either go into the army or you can go home and try and work things out with your mother. I wasn't fond of the army, but I decided to go home and try and reconcile with my mom, so I did. I had a job at that time, and when I went home, I wasn't home very long until me and my brother got into an altercation, and I was put in jail for 3 days. And I got out, and because I wasn't home, and I couldn't go to work, so I lost my job, and my mom was upset with me about that. So she said, you know, I want you to just get an understanding of how much I've sacrificed for you to be where you are today, so I want you to experience what it's like to live in a homeless shelter. So I ended up going there, but I had a very revengeful spirit towards my mother. And before she dropped me off, I ended up that night going in her car, taking her credit card number, and writing it down. And while I was in the homeless shelter for 6 months, I was taking money from my own mother. Well, the Bible does say you reap what you sow, right? And so I was there, and just one day, one of the guys in there told me, hey, the police are looking for you. I said, okay. Didn't worry about it. They came back again. Didn't worry about it. But the third time they called, and they talked to me directly and told me, we need you to come down to the station. We want to talk to you about a few things. I knew what it was about. So I went down there, told them everything. My mom, even, you know, though I made mistakes, those principles of do not lie were still in me. And I told them the truth. And I thought, since I told the truth, I'm scot-free. I'm not being funny, I really did. I just thought I was scot-free. And I get back one day from job searching, about lunchtime, and the next thing I know, there's three police officers coming down the hall. They read me my rights, and basically I just get put into the back of the police car, and I end up spending 6 months in jail. I get out at 12 o'clock at midnight, not knowing where I'm going to go. My mom didn't call me. You know, we still don't have the best relationship, but I believe God is working on my heart and her heart, and in time he will reconcile us one to another. And so I got out at 12 o'clock at midnight, didn't know what I was going to do, but what I didn't know was that God was about to start up a chain of events to place me exactly where he wanted me to be. Now, what I didn't tell you was that while I was in the boys' home, there was a lady who was a cook. And I didn't know it at the time, but she was a Seventh-day Adventist. And we just had this relationship for some reason, something about her and something about me, we just clicked. And so she was actually one of the first people to give me my Bible studies. And I'm just going to go back to where I finished off. I was 12 o'clock, went back to the boys' home, which was right down the road, talked to a few guys, and they said, you know, you'll be okay, just, you know, keep trying to go. And I did, and I called a police officer, and he dropped me about a mile away from my mom's house. So I have these three bags of clothes, which had all my past life in it, and I just want to make a very important point here, a spiritual lesson. When you stop chasing the wrong things, you give the right things a chance to catch you. I had everything that I loved, my dress, everything that made me like all my friends in those three bags. And I was walking to my mom's house, I was tired, it was late, and I just started crying out to God. I said, God, I can't do this anymore. Do you even care? And all I remember was dropping those three bags of clothes in the bushes, walking back to my mom's house, get to my mom's house. Long story short, she is not happy to see me. She says, you're just afraid of the consequences, which was true. And so I ended up sleeping on the front porch at 7 o'clock, till 7 o'clock in the morning. I get, my mom comes out in the morning, asks me, what are you doing here? It's like, I'm just sleeping on the front porch. She says, okay, you need to leave. I'm like, okay, just take me to go get my clothes and I'll leave you alone. So we went to go get my clothes that I had dropped, and I remember where I'd left them. And when I got there, guess what? They weren't there. So me and my mom get into another argument. And guess where she starts heading? To the police station. She goes inside, and one of the officers, I was a trustee in there, one of the officers came out, and he said, David, I just want you to know what's going on right now. I said, okay. He said, your mother wants to file a restraining order on you, but he said, you know, you worked well for me, you're a good kid, and I'm gonna let you go today. And when I look back on that now, I just say, that was God intervening on my behalf. And so I walked down the road, and I, probably for the first time in my life, really got serious with God, and I just started crying and pouring my heart to him. You know, Lord, what is left for me? My name has been tarnished. There's nothing good left for me. And I remember sitting under a pine tree and crying out. And the next thing I know, a lady drives by, and she asks me, do you need a place to stay for the night? I said, yes. But before we pull away, the Seventh-day Adventist woman's husband was mowing the lawn across the street. And I said, hey, can I go talk to him really quick? I know him too. So we do, and he says, my wife has been trying to get a hold of you. You need to call her right now. So I called her. We talked. She said, you know, when you get done staying at this lady's house, I want you to come to my house. I have some things I'd like to tell you, talk to you about. So I did. And while we talked, we stayed up for at least probably from about 9 o'clock one night till 2 o'clock in the morning. And all she was doing was telling me the love of Jesus, how Jesus loves you no matter how many mistakes you've made. And I just remember weeping and crying. And long story short, I eventually accepted the Advent message, and I was baptized. And a few years later, I was blessed and privileged after a lot of difficulties to be able to come to Heartland. And I believe that God has a special purpose for me, as he does for you. My burden, though, is for the outcasts of society, those who have been written off by the rest of the world and told there's no hope for you. Those are the people that God wants me to go to. Because I know that were it not for His grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. And I know how that would go, all the battles I would face, forever running, but losing the race, were it not for grace. Time measured out my days, life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could be gained, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running, but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw in full just how much His love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. The battles I would face, for for grace, forever running, but losing the race, were it not for grace.
Before I forget, when I was introducing the various nations, I forgot to mention a very special friend, or two special friends of mine from the Philippines. So they can show you that we have two members of the nation of the Philippines. Sorry about that. In the book of Revelation, John is given glimpses of heavenly praise. And we find, I believe this is Revelation 4 or Revelation 5, the reference is not given, but it says, "And I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and beasts and the elders. And the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing.' And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb forever and ever.' And the four beasts said, 'Amen.' And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever. God has promised us that one day heaven and earth will be filled with praise. There will be no more sadness, no more violence, death, or sin. And in the meantime, we can choose to sing his praises here in preparation for that glad morning."
They forgot Cuba.
One glad morning when my Jesus comes, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Hello? 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 Hello?
Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God and in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for thee. The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready? Would your heart be right if he came to? Promises of God all are true. Jesus bought your life on Calvary's mountain, and soon he will come again for you. The Lord is coming, are you ready? The Lord is coming, are you ready? Would your heart be right if he came tonight? The Lord is coming.
invite the congregation to stand for the benediction. And now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace, dismissing you with his blessing, but never from his presence, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. I want to thank the choir for coming. Thank you so much for your singing. It's been a good day. We invite the congregation to join our church family in a fellowship meal after.
Sabbath, please be seated.